Our children depend on our love, support, and protection on their journey from childhood to becoming adults. Let's uphold their right to safety, their right to be free from harm and all forms of abuse. Let's nurture them, teach them right, keep them bright, and build a more prosperous tomorrow today. Hi there, I'm Adrian Atkinson. Welcome to Jamaica Magazine. On today's show, making childcare and protection a labor of love, plus some heart healthy lifestyle practices to stay in good shape. There's still more to come, but to see it all, you'll have to stick around. So sit back and relax. One day our children will become the adults. Yeah, I know. Duh. But really, think about that. One day, not that far from now, that gapped-toothed toddler, that lanky preteen, or that know-it-all teen is going to become an adult. And if all goes well, one of this country's movers and shakers. So think about that. What that future Jamaica is going to look like if, as adults, they're struggling to cope with the lingering effects of childhood abuse or lack of attention. Are you envisioning well-adjusted adults, able to drive Jamaica's development for its next generation of future adults, or for us adults who will, by that time, be seniors dependent on them to take care of us in our old age? Not so much, right? Well, then I'm sure you'll understand why government wants you to embrace this message. Take a look.
Little child, dry your crying eyes. How can I explain the fear you feel inside?
They're among the most vulnerable groups in the society. And a unified approach to protecting their well-being is of the utmost importance to the health and the stability of our nation.
I again implore all Jamaicans to embrace the foundations on which Labor Day has been established. Community spirit, volunteerism have all been at the heart of what we do on Labor Day. Each of us must commit to taking on an activity this Labor Day that speaks to the protection of our children and youth. Just as importantly, please bear in mind that the protection of our children goes well beyond meeting their physical needs, such as for shelter, education, and health. It also involves nurturing, it involves love, it involves kindness, and it involves families. And I know that my Prime Minister often says that people accuse her of hugging too much, but she hugs because sometimes people have never been hugged in their life. So I would also implore you to follow the example of our Prime Minister and just hug somebody, even today.
My ministry, the programs and service for young people range from career development to employment facilitation, as well as training and certification. Child labor provisions are also going to be addressed in the OSHA legislation, with emphasis on access to good quality education in order to prevent child labor. But, ladies and gentlemen, and young people, more must be done, especially to make Vision 2030 development goals meaningful to children and engage their interests and involvement. This is why I'm glad that this Labor Day, the national task will be to recommit to creating a safer, more responsive and supportive environment for children and young adults. In particular, I want us to remember and focus on children and young people with disabilities and special needs. Shala, shala, shala la 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 la. Love to see the children play. Shala la la la.
labor of love, nurturing our children, could not have been a more appropriately chosen theme. I see it as a challenge to all of us to prove our love and care for our children and truly take tangible steps to protect them daily. We must regain that sense of vigilance and responsibility, where a village truly raises a child, not just this child month, but every day of every year. I endorse Labor Day 2015 and encourage every Jamaican adult to come out and do something practical to bring light into the lives of our children.
For Labor Day this year, we will work together for the children.
That's right.
In every community, let's show them that we care by creating and upgrading public spaces.
Hi, I'm Dorian.
I am Dominic.
And I'm Kimani.
This child month, hug your children.
Make them feel good about themselves.
And keep watching Jamaica Magazine.
Arts in the Park is back, this time showcasing the best of Jamaica's dance moves. This Sunday, May 17, at Hope Botanical Gardens. Find out which of Jamaica's dance crews will stomp their way into a contract with world-leading dance companies, Ailey 2, Dance Africa, and Block NYC. International dance choreographers and other groups will also be there scouting for the next team that can bring it. Let's dance.
If you've ever watched more than a week's worth of Jamaica Magazine, you've heard us talk about why it's important to eat well, exercise regularly, and cut out bad habits like smoking cigarettes. But how many of you have taken that message to heart? And speaking of, want to keep that organ pumping? Me too. So how about making a resolution to start adopting better lifestyle practices? Now's a good time to start. And believe me, when I tell you, it's a life or death kind of thing. Just take a look at this next feature and you'll see why.
We often associate the heart with emotions of joy and feelings of affection. Its image, even its pounding beat, has a firm link to expressions of love. But despite this much fondness, we have a tendency, without much thought, to put our hearts at risk of damage and, as a result, our lives in danger. How? Simply through improper diet and inadequate physical activity.
The evidence is well established and well known that a balanced diet is among the behaviors crucial to a healthy heart and circulation system.
And based on a 2008 health and lifestyle survey, most Jamaicans are not eating enough fruits, vegetables, and peas and beans, and are not as physically active as they should be.
The society has seemingly been taken with the bag juice, a love of processed and fast food with high salt, sugar, and fat content in these modern days. This is wreaking havoc on individuals' health and the resources of the health sector.
Having identified those factors believed to be contributing to the current trend in heart disease, the number one cause of death in Jamaica and the Caribbean, we must take the steps to avoid the dangers. Steps that include proper portion sizes and making healthy food choices. The Ministry of Health, in partnership with non-government organizations such as the Heart Foundation of Jamaica, is encouraging healthy eating habits to reduce the incidences of heart disease.
We continue to recommend healthy food choices in schools and other public institutions and promote the consumption of a variety of fruits and vegetables daily and the reduction of salt and fats in your diet. 30 minutes of physical activity per day, at least 3 times per week, and to make physical activity a part of your daily routine.
The ministry has also developed a manual on physical activity for the workplace to ensure that even while we work, we can enjoy the benefits of exercise. Eating just the required amount of nutrients has been proven to provide a healthy heart and circulatory system, while overindulging gives rise to cardiovascular diseases such as hypertension. And it's been found that heart disease is more common among people with hypertension or high blood pressure.
What hypertension does to the vessels we call arteries, which carry blood to the tissues. It causes a thickening of the wall of the arteries, the pulse we feel. The heart is getting bigger. It should require more blood, and it does. But at the same time, that pressure is also limiting the blood flow by causing hardening and narrowing of the vessels. So it's small wonder then there comes a time when the heart is going to be, its function is going to be seriously jeopardized.
Chronic kidney disease, another potential complication of hypertension, is also a contributor to the development of heart diseases. Since these diseases, which are common in adults, have been found to have their genesis in childhood years, eating healthy must start with our children.
If we can have an influence on our children with the intake and guide them on how they eat, we will start preventing generation after generation. A healthy child is one who eats fruits and vegetables.
To maintain good health, nutritionists recommend including items from all the food groups in our diets in the appropriate portions.
Challenge yourself. Don't eat processed food. Let's eat more natural, wholesome food where sodium is extremely low and natural. Let us try and eat one packaged food a day, but let us incorporate an average of 5 servings of fruit and vegetables. A serving is just an orange, just a banana, maybe 2 cups of lettuce, or 1 cup of pumpkin, or a cup of callaloo. That's all that a serving is.
Nutritionists also recommend that we avoid fried foods and instead broil, oven roast, and steam. It is important also to limit sugary beverages and foods with added sugars. The daily recommended intake for sugar is 6 teaspoons for women and 9 teaspoons for men. As it relates to sodium or table salt, our body needs less than 1 gram per day, and that's less than half a teaspoon. Measuring the quantity of sugar, salt, and fats requires us to be vigilant, reading labels and taking note of their quantity in each serving. In seeking to help Jamaicans make the shift from current unhealthy eating habits, the Ministry of Health has moved to provide food-based dietary guidelines. The availability of these guidelines and practical use by each of us is expected to result in a healthier nation with less non-communicable diseases. We'd be avoiding early deaths from heart conditions. So let's live more and love more. Let's make our food or medicine for good hearts and good health.
Know your numbers and control the keys to a healthier heart. Know the numbers for your blood pressure, cholesterol level, blood glucose level, and your weight and body mass index. Find out the risks they represent and what you need to do to stay healthy. Talk to your doctor and start making healthy lifestyle choices to prevent a heart attack or stroke.
What makes a good community, apart from good people that is? Decent homes, smooth roads, piped water, electricity, those and more. Government agrees and is partnering with the United Nations to address those issues and more in marginalized urban areas and informal settlements.
Our draft national housing policy has as its main objective to provide adequate housing, adequate affordable and legal housing to all Jamaicans.
Society's ideal is to have communities with quality homes, proper social and economic infrastructure, and systems to support a good life for its citizens. Over the years, as people seek this ideal, many have migrated from their rural communities to urban centers. This movement of people is often done informally, leading to the establishment of unplanned or squatter settlements that aren't equipped with the necessary infrastructure to support quality living. As the problem expands, solutions have to be found to correct what has started wrong and prevent more of the same in the future. A long time coming, but I know a change won't come. Oh, yes it will. With informal settlements come challenges like inadequate access to water, roads, and sanitation. Limited space, no legal ownership, and housing that are not durable due to the material used or location. In response to the Jamaican reality, government has framed a new urban development agenda and is moving to amplify corrective measures in these unplanned settlements. That work is currently being supported by the United Nations Participatory Slum Upgrading Program, PSUP.
The goals of the program correspond with the government's mandate, which is to increase the economic and social welfare of the populace and aid in capacity building.
Phase 2 of the UN's Participatory Slum Upgrading Program was launched on February 20, 2015. It targets 3 urban areas where there are small, medium, and large squatter settlements: Old Harbor Bay in St. Catherine, Maypen in Clarendon, and Montego Bay in St. James. 13 communities and thousands of Jamaicans will benefit initially. PSUP2 will bring together all development partners and strengthen the governance and management capacities of local, central, and regional institutions to improve these settlements. The work also seeks to establish and entrench regulations and policies for upgrading squatter settlements.
We are supposed to be preparing a city-wide slum situational analysis. This is where we're going to the different communities. We look at what is on the ground, we identify the gaps, we find the data on the communities in terms of housing, in terms of access to basic services, in terms of security, in terms of the governance framework, and we find the gaps and we make recommendations. Paramount is the building of the capacity of the persons at the community level. So the methodology that is used to get the communities involved is called participatory action planning.
Citizens are called upon to commit their time, skills, and to be integral in the decision-making process. Among their duties are to identify the challenges they face and determine what actions should be taken.
So it's not a top-down decision-making process, it's a bottom-up decision-making process, because you want to build the capacity of the persons in the communities. You want them to own the outcome of their project.
There is also a component for resource mobilization.
We have so many projects and programs that are being implemented across the country that are addressing basically maybe some of the same challenges. The program is seeking to leverage all of these resources, see how you can leverage these resources to make the impact of what is being done more meaningful, and also allowing for there to be some form of scaling up of some of these projects that will emanate from the process.
UN Habitat has provided $125,000 to undertake the work under phase 2 of the Participatory Slum Upgrading Program. It's set to end in September 2015, but before that, implementers will focus on action planning and development of program documents ahead of phase 3, when physical projects will be done. To avoid having developments done in isolation, resources are drawn from different ministries, departments, and agencies of government.
In terms of the management of the process, there is a national steering committee that has been established, and this is coordinated and managed by the Ministry of Transport, Works and Housing.
The program is the outcome of a tripartite arrangement between UN Habitat, the European Union Commission, and the African, Caribbean and Pacific ACP countries. Jamaica is among 5 countries in the Caribbean where the program is being implemented. The results will act as a blueprint for the management of the over 700 squatter settlements across Jamaica.
And as Minister with responsibility for housing, my remit is about the development of land to respond to the security of tenor of every Jamaican. Development in this instance means improved access to clean drinking water, adequate sanitation, upgrading of roadways, physical infrastructure, cleaning of drains and channels, as well as capacity building.
the Participatory Slum Upgrading Program, working with local authorities to secure social amenities and access to basic services, improving human settlement and helping Jamaica to achieve the goals of the Vision 2030 National Development Plan. I feel nice. A
sugar and spice. Jamaicans!
Jamaicans!
For Labor Day this year, we will work together for the children.
That's right.
In every community,
let's show them that we care.
By creating and upgrading public spaces,
so our children can feel safe.
To play, have fun, and bond together.
So come on, Jamaica, let's work together.
It's a labor of love,
nurturing our children. Labor Day, May 25th.
On the board this week, the Morant Bay High School Alumni Association will be having their fundraising event, Hats on MBHS Night, at the Waterfalls on Friday, May 22 at 160 Old Hope Road, Kingston 6. Come on out and support this worthy cause in aid of the Morant Bay High School Library. The Maranatha Gospel Hall Music Program Ministry presents its annual Evening of Excellence on Sunday, May 31 at the Maranatha Gospel Hall, 7 Deanery Road, Kingston 16, starting at 6 p.m. The event will feature the JCF Band and Choir, Paul Henry, and much more. An offering will be taken towards the restoration of the vestry. For more information, call 928-1098 or email maranatha1929@yahoo.com. You may also visit them online at maranathagospelhall.org. All fisher folk operating within southern Jamaican waters from west to east, and all other marine users and stakeholders operating within this area of Jamaica's southern coastal waters, are being asked to take note that a survey and some limited seafloor sampling activity is currently being conducted to understand marine geology. This will be done until the end of June, and all persons and vessels must take the necessary precautions. For further information, contact Tullow Jamaica Limited, 22B Old Hope Road, Kingston 5, or email david.barrett@tullowoil.com, or call 342-9996. And that's all for our community notices today. Send us your events for a broadcast on the JIS Community Notice Board. Call 922-868022 or send an email to cbishop@jis.gov.jm.
Lower House passes legislation to establish the CCJ as Jamaica's final court of appeal. We recap that and other news developments next.
Hi there, I'm Simone Wolf with your JIS News of the Week. The new head of the IMF mission to Jamaica, Uma Ramakrishnan, this week reported that Jamaica had passed the 8th IMF test and was poised to receive another $40 million from the multilateral agency. She said all quantitative targets for the January to March 2015 period were met, except the primary balance, which was $4.1 billion less than projected due to lower than anticipated revenues to government.
The lower revenue reflects lower inflation and the impact of drought and other external shocks to growth. Nevertheless, primary surplus is still estimated at 7.5% of GDP, and that is the central fiscal anchor of the program.
Our progress thus far is, in our view, commendable by any standard, and while we have successfully navigated the first 2 years, we still have much to accomplish.
On Tuesday, this development in the House of Representatives.
A bill entitled An Act to Amend the Constitution of Jamaica to provide for the replacement of appeals to Her Majesty in Council with new provisions for appeals to the Caribbean Court of Justice as Jamaica's final appellate court and for connected matters read a third time and passed.
That was one of three bills passed to have the Caribbean Court of Justice replace the UK-based Privy Council as Jamaica's final court of appeal. It required and got a two-thirds majority vote, while the other two accompanying bills were passed by a simple majority. All three pieces of legislation will now move to the Senate for its approval. During Tuesday's sitting, parliamentarians also passed the Constitution Amendment Local Government Act 2014 to entrench local government in Jamaica's constitution.
The changes proposed in this legislation
are the best means of accommodating local government. As an active, functional organ of development within the Constitution.
The new legislation gives local authorities the ability to perform regulatory functions and allows Parliament to make provisions for them to generate and spend their own revenue and to provide for the holding of local government elections. The Agriculture Ministry will be providing coffee farmers with 100,000 seedlings for replanting in the fall crop as part of measures to have the sector rebound from the damage caused by bushfires in the Blue Mountain Belt this week.
In addition, Mr. Speaker, the Ministry will be assisting with the provision of some inputs to assist with the replanting program, fertilizers, etc., etc.
Minister Kellyer also reported that the Housing Ministry would be replacing houses destroyed by the fire, while other assistance was coming from the Ministry of Labour and Social Security. In the meantime, he had an appeal for farmers.
I'm beseeching our farmers to resist the temptation to light fires. And I urge you to speak to your RADA officers about alternate means of clearing lands.
Cabinet has approved proposals to amend the Child Care and Protection Act and the Criminal Justice Administration Act to bring about stiffer penalties for persons who abuse children or fail to protect them. Stiffer penalties will also be imposed on persons who murder, rape, or commit other serious violent offenses against children.
The victim's status as a child will be treated as an aggravating feature, resulting in a substantial uplift in the sentence on conviction.
The Information Minister said the Child Care and Protection Act was also being amended to insert parental neglect and failure of an adult to report suspected exposure of a child to sexual or other abuses.
Efforts are being made to ensure that cases relating to violence against children will be afforded priority scheduling and disposal in the courts.
$38.2 million will be spent to develop a modern public transportation center in Lindsay, St. Catherine.
When completed, I firmly believe that it will provide for a more organized public transportation system and should ease the pressure in the town, particularly during peak hours.
When it's completed, the transport center will be able to accommodate 400 public transport operators. And finally, 27 buses have been added to the fleet of the Jamaica Urban Transit Company, the JUTC, boosting the public transportation system in Jamaica. One will be used in the Montego Bay metropolitan region, and 16 will be added to the company's corporate area service. The remaining 10 will be added to the JUTC's premium service.
But they will represent a special category within our premium fleet to be known as European Luxury, or Eurolux for short. Those buses will significantly add to our capacity to provide charter services as well as special premium services on our suburban routes into the business district of Kingston.
And those were some of the stories making news this week. I'm Simone Wolf.
This is where we close Jamaica Magazine for today. We're back tomorrow with more useful information. In the meantime, keep the link. Use our Facebook and Twitter pages, YouTube channel, and the GIS website to stay in touch and get the very latest government information. On behalf of the entire team here at the GIS, I'm Adrian Atkinson, reminding you to eat well, exercise regularly, and get some rest as you make every day a productive one.
This has been a production of the Jamaica Information Service, the voice of Jamaica.